a cryptocurrency. And the blockchain technology, which supports it. Don't ask me, because I'm just beginning to study this subject. I don't even have time to do it. And that Bitcoin should have started at such a little bit of money for one Bitcoin, and then keep on going up and up and up and up and up until we're somewhere about 15,000-20,000 now.
20.
Yes. These are not ordinary events taking place in the world of money. so I would like to share the time tonight with devoting time, first of all, to the subject of money. I don't know whether you're familiar with my thoughts on the subject. If you've been, no. I have a book entitled The Gold Dinar and Silver Dirham, Islam and the Future of Money, written about 10 years ago, in which I have tried to go to the Quran to define what is money. It is lamentable that we consistently ignore the Quran in the pursuit of knowledge. So before I proceed, I have a story to tell you. I did my master's in philosophy at Karachi University, and I completed the first degree at the Alimi Institute of Islamic Studies in Pakistan, Karachi, under the guidance of my teacher, Maulana Fadlur Rahman, Muhammad Fadlur Rahman Ansari, rahimahullah. And I was too impatient to stay for the second degree. I wanted out. My mother was ill. Maulana cried, but I wanted out. We are stupid when you're young. But before I left, he hugged me. He said, I know the character of this ummah. He doesn't want me to be an imam in a masjid, and he who pays the piper calls the tune. He wants me to be able to function independently, earn my own livelihood, so I can give a khutbah. And if you don't like it, you can't fire me. So I went back home and I applied for the Foreign Service of Trinidad and Tobago. And they interviewed me, the panel of interviewers. And they said, we would like to have you in the Foreign Service, Mr. Hussein. You will bring to the Foreign Service something richer for us. But we want you to go back to university and do a postgraduate degree in international relations. The government of Trinidad and Tobago had turned, at the time of independence, very sensibly so to Switzerland, not to the United States and not to Britain. For the Swiss government to get the Graduate Institute of International Studies in Geneva, the most famous institution of Europe, to establish a branch in Trinidad to train diplomats for the Caribbean. So the Swiss were running the institute for about 10 years, training diplomats. And the class was limited to about 20, 23 people. And you were selected from different islands, from the foreign ministries and so on. Very, very, very difficult to get in. The year that I was sent was the first year that we had local people take over from the Swiss. And the director of the institute was a man from Haiti, Professor Dr. Leslie Maniga. In all my life, have never met a man with such brilliance, absolute brilliance, in the analysis of political affairs and political history and so on. But when I entered the class of 23 students, they were all graduates from British universities and American universities and French universities, Canadian, and poor, poor, poor Imran, Pakistani degree. So they're all looking down, what is he doing here with a Pakistani degree? And worse still, he's studying to be a priest, a Muslim priest. What is he doing here amongst us diplomats? So they were looking down at me. What they didn't know, and they were soon to know, was that I was not coming to the classroom alone. I was coming into the classroom with the Quran. And my teacher had taught me how to use the Quran to study politics, to study economics, to study monetary economics, to study sociology, to study psychology, the technology, the methodology, how to do it. Go to the Quran to study, as you do in medicine. When the classes started, and I started asking questions and making comments, their mouths were open. They're looking around at each other. They couldn't believe it. One voice in the whole class. At the end of the 1 year, I had never studied economics in my life before. At the end of the year, I came first at the exams. I beat the fellow with a master's degree from the London School of Economics. I beat him in economics. How did I do it? How did I do it? I did it because my teacher had taught me how to go to the Quran as the fountain of all knowledge, absolute knowledge in the Quran. This is a first sign of respect for the Quran, that you do not bypass the Quran when you study microbiology. You do not bypass the Quran when you're studying physics. You go first to the Quran, but you must have the methodology of how to study the Quran. If we had that methodology, we would not be where we are today. When I went to Pakistan in 1964, $1, you wouldn't believe it. $1 was worth 1 rupee, 1 rupee 75 paisas. You remember that?
Not that old.
You're not that old.
Unfortunately.
Okay. You make me feel good now.
I'm glad I make somebody.
$1 was 1 rupee 75 paisas at that time. So in my lifetime, I have lived to see the total collapse of money in Pakistan. Shameful, catastrophic collapse. And in consequence of that, an Indian Muslim community, which 100 years ago was sending money to the Arabs to help them with their poor, and they were dependent on money from India because they were so poor. 100 years later, these people are now so poor, anywhere in the world they can get a passport to get out. They want out, because this is hell. And Bangladesh, the same thing, and Indonesia, the same thing, and Morocco, the same thing, and Algeria, the same thing, and Tunisia, the same thing. And the list is endless, the whole of Africa, the same thing. And how did it happen? Like a the vacuum cleaner that you use to clean the carpet, it sucks the monetary system functioning like a vacuum cleaner, sucking the wealth of the rest of the world, and bringing that wealth to another part of the world. Such a part. It is, of course, unjust. It is unethical. It is ripping off people. And in the Quran, it's called riba. In the Quran, it's called riba. And the very last revelation to come to the Prophet just before he died, is after he made the Hajj, the farewell Hajj. And he returns to Medina and he has 81 days left in his life. During those 81 days, Allah sends the last revelation. And in the last revelation, he declares war on riba. The strongest language in the whole Quran is here. If you do not give up your demand for riba, then take notice of a declaration of war from Allah and His Messenger. This is the last revelation to come down. And if we neglect the subject of riba, then we are betraying the Quran. Betraying the Quran. If we had been faithful to the Quran, then we would have gone to the Quran to study what is money. Because I took the Quran into the classroom. At the end of the 1 year of postgraduate studies, I came first in the class in international politics, in international economics, not in international law, I wasn't good in that, in the history of international relations, in diplomacy, Islam. I came first in the class. And the reason for that was the Quran. We have this, therefore, this imperative today. If we are to even understand the phenomenon of cryptocurrencies and bitcoins and electronic money and digital money, which is about to sweep the world, and the beginning of the process a year and a few months ago, with an Indian government that is acting as a shoeshine boy of Wall Street. That's what the Indian government is doing now. Betraying the Hindu religion. Because the Hinduism is emphatic in its requirement of honesty in business. Yes. And I have to remind the pundits of that your government is betraying Hinduism the way every Pakistani government has betrayed Islam from day one. The Indian government a year and a few months ago demonetized the two biggest banknotes or money, currency notes. In India, the 1,000 rupee note and the 500 rupee note. And we subsequently realized that this was the beginning, the initial phase of what is eventually going to become the demonetization of all paper money. You begin with the big notes until eventually you will be embraced in something that is fascinatingly called a cashless world. They have this peculiar capacity to create expressions that are exotic in nature. A cashless world. And now you don't need cash anymore. You know, it's only a dum-dum who walks around with cash in his pocket. Sensible, intelligent people who are able to move with the times, to move with a changing world, because you have to be intelligent, you know, and intelligent people have a smartphone. because the phone is smart. So you now use a card and you swipe and swipe and swipe and pay all your bills and so on. Everything is done electronically. Why is this happening? And is this money halal or haram? The European Union then announced that the 500 euro note, which is the biggest note in Europe, will be demonetized this year. And in Sweden and the Scandinavian countries now, I'm told that about 1% of transactions now are done in cash. 99% of all transactions are now being done electronically. When we go to the Quran to study the subject of money, we find that in the Quran there's the word dinar. And the dinar in the Quran is a coin of gold. And it was used as money. It was used as money for thousands of years.
In Iraq it's still used.
It was used as money by all the prophets of Allah. It was used as money by our messenger, our prophet, whose birth anniversary is celebrated with gusto, with shining lights and beating drums and wah, 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 wah. He used this money before dinner. And in the Quran, there is the dirham, the silver coin. And it was used as money for buying and selling. And when we make the mistake to remind them of this, they are suddenly silent. Ominously silent. Shamefully silent. Why don't you just leave us to beat the drums, man? This is Miladun Nabi. The Prophet is this and that and that and that and that and that and that. But we don't want to be reminded of this one. That is a dangerous and ominous development. It's a spade, and you have to have the courage to call a spade, regardless of consequences. And I don't care two peanuts at all about those who are offended when I expose their hypocrisy. Celebrating the praises of the Prophet, singing his praises, chanting his praises, reminding he is this and he is that and he is that and he is that and he is that. Dividing themselves from all other Muslims because of this extremely great love they have for Allah's Messenger. And yet, these pathetic creatures don't want to hear that he used dinar and dirham as money. I have to denounce these pathetic creatures. They can throw stones at me if they want. I don't care two peanuts who they are. You are betraying the Messenger of Allah. I cannot even remind you that this is money in the Quran. I cannot even remind you that this is money in the Sunnah, that he used this money. And when Imam al-Mahdi comes, it is this money he's going to be using, not the US dollar. And when Nabi Isa alayhi salam returns, it is this money he'll be using. And when we look to the Quran, we find not only the gold dinar, we find the silver dirham, we find kintar, and a kintar is a treasure. In a monetary system built on gold and silver coins as money, in which, sorry, Allah's law is applied, no one can accumulate wealth beyond a kintal. That is the maximum you can reach before the system intervenes to break down wealth. And a kintar is about 1,200 dinars. Today, with this sophisticated monetary order which has come from the Western world, one man can earn more wealth than the whole of Pakistan combined. Look at what is there in the Quran and look at what is there in their monetary system. Shamelessly. That one man or a handful of people, a dozen people, could earn and be more wealthy than the whole of Africa. Something is smelling stink in that monetary system to produce this atrocious imbalance, this huge accumulation of wealth in the hands of a few, and the masses around the world living in abject, miserable poverty. And then you go and put salt in the wound and blame them for their poverty. And these who are wealthy, they are industrious, they are sensible, they are wise. And that's how they become rich. Except for one Pakistani man who came to see me 2 weeks ago and was worried that they had left Pakistan and come here and they had worked so hard to build themselves here so they can leave for their children and their grandchildren something of substance. And this miserable son that he has wants to go back to Pakistan. So he came to me for help. He said, Sheikh, let me tell you, it was Allah who ordained all the wealth to come here because Allah knew we were going to come here. So he brought the wealth here so we would have the wealth. Yes, this happened 2 weeks ago. When we turned to the Quran, we find not only dinar and dirham and kintar, but in Surah Al-Kahf, the young men slept in the cave for 300 years. And when they woke up, they were hungry and they had some money. And the Quran describes it as worry. And we're not really interested in the meaning of the word worry. That's not important. What is important is that after 300 years, this money had functioned successfully as a store of value. That if it could buy this amount of food 300 years ago, it could still buy it today. The most important money in the world today, on the basis on whose base the whole world of money rests, is the US dollar. If you don't know that, you've got to go to the International Monetary Fund and study it. And Bretton Woods and study it. If you had 20 US dollars 100 years ago, with that 20 US dollars, you could buy an ounce of gold. Yeah. And if you take the same 20 US dollars today, not only can you not buy the ounce of gold, you probably cannot even get more than a grain, because an ounce of gold now is about 1,200, 1,300, 1,400 dollars. Huh? But look at, compare this with that. When I was in 1947, I was 5 years of age. Were you born as yet?
Long
you
way.
You were still young. In 19, 1947, I was 5 years of age. My father was a school principal, and he bought a car, a British Hillman Minks car, so he could take me to school. But he'll now also take me to the market on Saturdays, and I'll be there 5 years of age with my little basket, going with my father. And I saw him buy 100 oranges, wholesale price, for $1 of our money. 70 years later, when I go to the same market with $1, I can't buy even one orange. Compare this with that, which is in the Quran. There is yet another reference to money in the Quran. This one shows that this money successfully functions as money in terms of the function of money as a store of value. This one doesn't leak. And then there is yet another reference to money in the Quran, again in Surah Al-Kahf, of a man who is dying and was leaving orphans behind. He dug a hole and he buried the money and then built a structure, a wall. And since Surah Al-Kahf is the Surah of Akhir al-Zaman, it is intended to send a message to us 1400 years later that when they come with their senses, they will not be able to find the money because you built a structure on top of it. Now I ask, can you bury electronic money? Can you bury bitcoins? When we go, we leave the Quran and we go to the Hadith, how much time do I have?
You can, we've got this cover. How much time?
This is my last lecture. I'm leaving tomorrow, so I don't mind spending.
It's up to you. Cover, it's up to you, sir.
The companion of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, Bilal, radiallahu ta'ala, came to the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, and offered him some dates. The Prophet said, Bilal, these are high quality dates. Where did you get them? Bilal said, O Messenger of Allah, I had two sa'a, but today we might use the word kilogram, 2 kilograms of inferior quality dates, and I exchange them for this 1 kilogram of superior quality dates. In value, it was a fair exchange. The Prophet said, Bilal, this is the essence of riba, and that's a very big sin. Allah and His Messenger waging war. What you should have done was to sell the 2 kilograms of inferior quality dates and take that money and buy the 1 kilogram. But a direct exchange of dates for dates that was unequal, was haram, was riba. But Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu exchanged 4 camels for 1. These were baby camels, this was an adult. And that was not haram, and that was not riba. An unequal exchange of camels, no problem. An unequal exchange of dates, haram, riba. Why? You have to ask Mufti the answer question. Ask him. The answer lies in another hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is speaking about a transaction which involves an exchange of gold for gold, or silver for silver, or wheat for wheat, or barley for barley, or dates for dates as this one, or salt for salt. 6 things. And he says, if you have such a transaction, it must be equal for equal. If you have 1 kilogram on this side, you must have 1 kilogram on this side. You cannot have two. It must be equal for equal. And he said one more thing. It must be hand to hand, meaning it cannot be a credit transaction. If it is hand to hand, it cannot be a credit transaction. When we examine all six, we find that they were all used as money. If there was a shortage of gold and silver coins in the market in Yathrib, which is today called Medina, then they would use dates as money. Of course, you will use dates as money for microtransactions. You won't buy a house with dates. Therefore, from this we have a theory of money, which emerges from the Quran and Sunnah, that money in Islam is always either gold and silver, or when gold and silver are in short supply, then money in Islam will always be an article of food consumption, which, number one, is in abundant supply in the market, which, number two, has a shelf life. It's not like mangoes. And number three, it has intrinsic value. The value of the money is always in the money created by Allah. That value can fluctuate based on demand and supply, but is always a value created by Allah and not by a man named George Soros. Because dates were used as money, if you allow a transaction of an exchange of 1 kilogram for two, you will open the door for the money lender, who will now lend you 1 kilogram of dates, and you'll have to return 2 kilograms of dates, which constitute a loan with 100% interest. But because animals could not be used as money, it was permissible to have an unequal exchange of animals. So there you are. In just a few minutes, I've introduced you to what is money in the Quran and what is money in the Sunnah. And this is what money was all through the ages, except that we had a very, very, very strong law in Islam. Punishment is sometimes reformatory. I'm punishing you to make you a better person. That is the philosophy of punishment for alcohol and alcoholism. We punish you to try to get you out of the alcohol. Punishment can also be, I don't know if this is the correct word, retaliatory punishment or something else better than that. Anyhow, if you take a life, then justice demands that you pay for it with your life, a life for a life. The law of equity. There's a special word for it, I'm escaping. This is reformatory, and this is something else. And then there's punishment, which is deterrent punishment. I'm punishing you not just for what you did, but I'm punishing you to ensure that nobody else will do what you did. Deterrent punishment. Allah reserves deterrent punishment for someone who is stealing. Sometimes you steal by putting your hand in the man's pocket, but many times you steal because your hand is underneath the table. And the punishment is to cut off the hand. There are those who are more learned than Allah, and they say this is barbaric punishment because they have more knowledge than Allah. Yes. But when you apply this punishment, like for example, one of you take control of Pakistan, you know, from the government, and you said, I want to ensure that this country will function on the basis of honesty. That's my first priority. So those who are stolen, we give them a certain amount of time. Come forward, confess for what you have stolen, and return what you have stolen. And then our court may decide to have amnesty. You may be forgiven. When that date is over, then after that, whoever we arrest and try and is found guilty of what today they call it corruption, we're going to cut off your hands.